In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
The question I want to ask you is, are you really a Christian? And do you know for sure what you are? What's the answer to that question? Let's pray before we look in the Bible. Father in heaven, we thank you for the scriptures that teach us the way to eternal life, and we humbly but earnestly pray that as we study your word now, that you will open its meaning to us and help us to understand what you're trying to teach us from the prophets and the apostles and from our Lord Jesus. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. This paragraph was written over 100 years ago. It reads like this: "None are living Christians unless they have a living experience in the things of God and daily practice self-denial, cheerfully bearing the cross and following Christ. Every living Christian will advance daily in the divine life. As he advances toward perfection, he experiences a conversion to God every day. And this conversion is not complete until he attains to the perfection of Christian character and a full preparation for the finishing touch of immortality." There are going to be people in this world when Jesus comes that will be translated and taken to heaven and never die. There are going to be people like that. The Bible predicts that very clearly in 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter. But the question is, if you're alive when Jesus comes, will you be one of those people? And we are drawing very near the end of this world's history. This world is rapidly coming to an end. And as we near the close of time, we need to devote ourselves to a study of the plan of salvation. And the first thing I want to say about the plan of salvation and being a Christian is that you and I, we are not saved as a church. We are not saved as families. We're saved only as individuals. What does that mean? Well, that means that just because my wife is saved, that doesn't mean that I'll be saved. Just because my son or daughter, my father or mother is saved, that does not mean that I'll be saved. Jesus was very, very clear in teaching about this. If you have your Bible, open it to Luke, the 17th chapter. And we'll read what Jesus said about this point. Luke, the 17th chapter. Start reading in verse 32. You can preach a whole sermon easily on Luke 17:32, even though the sentence is only three words long in English. We'll read from verse 32 to verse 37. "Remember Lot's wife. Whoever seeks to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will preserve it. I tell you, in that night, there will be two in one bed. The one will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding together. The one will be taken and the other left. Two men will be in the field. The one will be taken and the other left." They answered and said to him, "Where, Lord?" So he said, when they said, where, Lord, they're talking about what's going to happen to the one that's left. What is going to be happen to the one that's left? Here's what Jesus says. So he said to them, wherever the body is, there the eagles, or the vultures, the buzzards, will be gathered together. You want to read about that, look in Revelation, the 19th chapter. It talks about the ones that are left. Revelation 19, verse 21. It says, the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh. Wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together. So, Jesus said there'll be two in one bed. The one will be taken, the other one will be left. Where, Lord? Well, wherever the body is, the eagles will be gathered together. There'll be two women grinding in the mill. One will be taken, the other will be left. Where, Lord? Wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together. There'll be two men in the field. One will be taken, the other will be left. Where, Lord? Wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together. It's important, my friend, for you and for me individually to understand the plan of salvation. This passage shows that I'm not saved because somebody else is saved. Oh, we're sleeping in the same bed. We're closely related. Well, that doesn't matter. We're not saved as families. We're only saved as individuals. What happens? What happens when people do not understand the plan of salvation? I want to read to you something that was written a long time ago about what was happening and going to happen in the Adventist church, in Adventism. First sentence says, we may look for anything now to break forth outside and within our ranks. You can look for anything? Yes, you can look for anything to happen. You don't know what will happen. Anything can happen. And there are minds undisciplined by the grace of the Holy Spirit that have not practiced the words of Christ and who do not understand the movings of the Spirit of God. There are some people's minds that are undisciplined. Do you know what discipline means? To many people today, that is a bad word. They want to just do anything they please. Are you aware of the fact that that's what Lucifer decided in heaven? He wanted to just do whatever he pleased. Are you aware of the fact that that's the first temptation that came to Eve in the Garden of Eden? If you eat of this fruit, you'll be like gods. In other words, what does it mean to be like God? Can God do anything he pleases? Yes, he can. God is the only person, persons we could say, God is the only one in the universe that can do whatever he pleases. Incidentally, he's the only one that it's safe for him to do whatever he pleases. And so, Eve fell over this temptation to do whatever you please. This is a very common philosophy and feeling in the world today. I want to do what I want to do. Mind is not disciplined by the Holy Spirit. Have you thought through the meaning of that sentence? Let me read it again. There are minds undisciplined by the grace of the Holy Spirit that have not practiced the words of Christ and who do not understand the movements of the Spirit of God. They're undisciplined. The Holy Spirit is not working on their mind. When the Holy Spirit begins to work on a person's mind immediately, that person is going to start to be a subject of discipline. Their minds are going to be disciplined. I want to say this kindly. I want you to get the point. There will be no undisciplined minds in the kingdom of heaven, period. There won't be any. So if you don't like discipline, if you don't want to be disciplined, discipline has to do with order and self-control. And of course, you know, order is heaven's first law. Sin is a disorganizer. And so there are minds that are undisciplined. Now, that is a huge subject that we are not going to take time to investigate more in detail right now. Just remember this fact. There will be not a single undisciplined mind in the kingdom of heaven. He says, these who are undisciplined by the grace of the Holy Spirit that have not practiced the words of Christ and who do not understand the movements of the Spirit of God, who will follow a wrong course of action because they do not follow Jesus fully, they follow impulse and their own imagination. What are they doing? They're following impulse and their own imagination. He says, let there be nothing done in a disorderly manner. Let nothing be done in a disorderly manner. By the way, I'm trying to learn that myself. Let nothing be done in a disorderly manner. Do you understand what an orderly person Jesus is? Let me just read you a couple things. Look in John 20. John 20. And look here. This is the day of the resurrection. This is John 20, verses 6 to 8. It says, then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the clean linen cloths lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lined with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. Now notice, when John, the disciple John who followed, came with Peter, when John saw, and Peter, when they saw this face cloth, I've described this before, this was a cloth that when a person died, they wrapped it from the chin over to the top of the head. That kept the mouth of a dead person closed. They wrapped it like this from the bottom of the chin up around the top of the head and tied it. Jesus had one of those cloths on his head when he was in the tomb. And this face cloth, when Jesus arose, this is just a piece of cloth. And he didn't pull it off and throw it down. He took it and he folded it. Now, friends, this is the King of the universe. This is the majesty of heaven. He took that cloth and he folded it and he laid it down in a place by itself. That's what the Scripture says. And the disciples knew how orderly a person Jesus was. And when they saw that, they knew that he had done it because it was the way he had done it. There's several instances like that recorded in the Gospel. Here's another one. Look in Luke 24. Luke 24, verses 29-31. It says, they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table, this is the day of the resurrection, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. When Jesus took the bread and he offered thanks for it, blessed it, and then he broke it, when they looked at that, they recognized that that's the way Jesus would do it, and they looked at it, and it was him. Jesus did not do anything in a disorderly manner. There's many, many illustrations of this throughout the gospel story. Jesus was a person who was disciplined. He lived an orderly life. Those that followed him lived orderly lives. The Apostle Paul said, "Let nothing be done that is out of order." You read that in 1 Corinthians 14. But there are some people who follow impulse in their own imagination, and the result is disorder. Order is heaven's first law. And there will be no disorder in heaven again. The disorderly elements have been cast out of heaven. They will never be allowed to return. If you would like to return, you must become a person who is orderly, a person who is disciplined. Now, we are going to study about the plan of salvation in a practical sense. I learned a long time ago that people like it when preachers preach in generalities, but when you start getting specific, then people get unhappy. They say you're just stepping on their toes. But if we don't get specific so we know exactly what we're talking about, well then, how are you going to get help to the kingdom of heaven if you don't know what we're talking about and it's not specific? So, let's go first of all to the Gospel of John again. We studied this in our Sabbath school lesson this morning. Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter. And verses 3-5. Jesus is answering. He's speaking to Nicodemus, who is one of the leaders of the Jews. He's a member of the Sanhedrin and a very wealthy man. He was looked up to by all the people of his generation. He was considered to be a righteous man and a holy man. He fully expected that he would be taken someday to the kingdom of heaven. But Jesus told him that something had to happen or he wasn't even going to go to heaven. Notice what Jesus said to him. He said, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus was startled. He couldn't comprehend a kingdom that was so pure that he couldn't be part of it. He was considered one of the most righteous and holy men of the nation. And so you can read in verse 4 that Nicodemus got very sarcastic. In response to his sarcastic question in verse 4, Jesus made the same statement again, only he became more explicit so that it would be impossible to misunderstand. Here's what Jesus said in verse 5. "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Unless you're born of water and the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. What's that about? Nicodemus understood full well that Jesus was referring to water baptism and to the power of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you're born of the Holy Spirit transforms your life. you become an entirely different person, an entirely new person. Here's what Ellen White says about it in the book Periodical Youth Instructor, October 2, 1902. Whatever may be your defects, the Holy Spirit will reveal them, and grace will be given you to overcome. Jesus made it very clear in John the 16th chapter, the first work of the Holy Spirit, when I receive the Holy Spirit, the first work of the Holy Spirit is to reveal to me the sin in my life. If a person doesn't know about their sinful condition or thinks that they're okay, all that means is that they haven't received the Holy Spirit yet. The first work of the Holy Spirit is to reveal to a person the sin in their life. Notice what the Apostle John says about this, the same writer that wrote the Gospel of John, in 1 John, the first chapter. He says in verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. So the first work of the Holy Spirit is to reveal to me the sin in my life. But the Holy Spirit comes to do more than reveal the sin in my life. The Holy Spirit comes to, turn to John the 16th chapter, where Jesus is talking about this. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. He says in verse 8, when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. That's the first work. The second work is to bring in righteousness. The Holy Spirit wants to bring to you the grace. People don't understand what grace is. We better explain that. Grace has to do with the power of God. Do you need the power of God in your life? I meet people all the time, they say to me in one way or another, they say, well, I have this problem, I have this habit, and I can't overcome it. And that's true. They can't overcome it, and yet they can't go to heaven unless they do overcome it. So what is the answer to that dilemma? The answer to that dilemma is, if you receive the Holy Spirit, you will have the power to overcome your bad habits. Beholding Christ, we are changed through the power of the Holy Spirit. When this change takes place, the hands, the tongue, the feet act in accord with the heart's spiritual advancement. The converting power of God molds us after the divine similitude, after the likeness of one who is the way, the truth, and the life. The Holy Spirit first convicts of sin, but then it shows a person how, by the divine power, he might overcome his defects of character. Righteousness. But the Holy Spirit does more than convict of sin and give a person power to overcome. What is the third thing Jesus mentions in that verse? Judgment to come. We are living in that time when that judgment to come is going to come. It's going to happen. When the Holy Spirit transforms a person, what is the result? When the Holy Spirit transforms a person, what is the result? Now we're getting into the heart, the meat of what I want to study with you. If the Holy Spirit is working in my life, if I've been born of the Spirit, if the Holy Spirit is working in my life, what is going to happen in my life? We're going to try to describe this in a very practical sense. And let me just say this before we get started. When I read to you the description, if that is not happening in my life, then I have not yet been baptized by the Holy Spirit. The great majority of people in the world who profess to be Christians are not having the experience that I'm going to read to you about, the experience that happens whenever a person is born again and baptized with the Holy Spirit. Here it is. Let the law of kindness be upon your lips and the oil of grace in your heart. This will produce wonderful results. You will be tender, sympathetic, courteous. Three words. Tender, sympathetic, and courteous. You need all these graces. The Holy Spirit must be received and brought into your character. Then it will be as holy fire, giving forth incense which will rise up to God, not from lips that condemn, but as a healer of the souls of men. The Holy Spirit is spoken of many times in the Bible as a fire. Open your Bible to Matthew, the 3rd chapter. Matthew 3, verse 11. John the Baptist is talking about the Messiah to come. He says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Notice what happened when the disciples received the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Look in Acts, the 2nd chapter. It says, verse 3, this is when the disciples at Pentecost received the Holy Spirit. It says, then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each one of them. It appeared like there were tongues of fire. Now, we studied about this a little bit, didn't we, in our Sabbath school this morning. And people think that this is just talking about speaking other languages or unknown languages. I have meditated some on why did the Holy Spirit choose to be manifested as tongues of fire. That is something very interesting to study. The way that you and I, the way that we use our tongue, gives evidence to the whole universe whether we have been baptized of the Holy Spirit or not. The statement I just read said, the Holy Spirit must be received and brought into your character, then it will be as holy fire. Holy fire, giving forth incense, which will rise up to God, not from lips that condemn, but as a healer of the souls of men. If I have received the Holy Spirit, it will change the way that I speak. It will be like holy fire, she says. Now, let's look at the difference between holy fire and common fire. Have you all read in the Old Testament about holy fire and common fire? Let's just read one statement real quick. In the Old Testament, in Leviticus, the 10th chapter, and verse 1 and 2, it says, then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense on it, and offered profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. So fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died. Did it make a difference whether you're using holy fire or common fire? If I've received the Holy Spirit, she says it will be like holy fire that will come out from my mouth, be offered incense before God will be like holy fire. What I speak will be like holy fire. What's the common fire? Let me go on reading. The Holy Spirit must be received and brought into your character. Then it will be as holy fire, giving forth incense which will rise up to God, not from lips that condemn, but as a healer of the souls of men. Your countenance will express the image of the divine. No sharp, listen to these adjectives, no sharp, critical, blunt, or severe words should be spoken. This is common fire. What's the common fire? Did you get it? The common fire is the sharp, critical, blunt, severe words. That's the common fire. How is it in your life, friend? Or when you speak, is it holy fire or is it common fire? Let me read that again. No sharp, critical, blunt, or severe words should be spoken. This is common fire and must be left out of all our counsels and intercourse with our brethren. God requires every soul in His service to kindle their censers from the coals of sacred fire. The common, severe, harsh words that come forth from your lips so readily must be withheld, and the Spirit of God speak through the human agent. By beholding the character of Christ, you will become changed into His likeness. The grace of Christ alone can change your heart, and then you will reflect the image of the Lord Jesus. God calls upon us to be like Him, pure, holy, and undefiled. We are to bear the divine image. Well, how is it in your life when you speak? Is it like holy fire or is it like common fire? If I have received the Holy Spirit, I will quit speaking with common fire. I will quit using the sharp, severe, blunt, harsh language. If I don't do that, well, then that's evidence that I haven't been born of the Holy Spirit yet. The Holy Spirit hasn't transformed my life yet. Because one of the first results that happens when a person receives the Holy Spirit is a change in their speech, I want to read to you from the Bible how closely related our speech is to whether or not we have the Holy Spirit working in us. Let's read it. Look in your Bible in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. The Apostle Paul gets very specific about this. Ephesians, the fourth chapter, starting with verse 29. He says, "Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor." By the way, do you know what clamor is? Clamor is loud quarreling and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ also forgave you. So, a distinction between the person who has received the Holy Spirit and the person who has not received the Holy Spirit, is not living in the Spirit, is the way they speak. The way they speak. And this change in the way a person speaks is not something that just happens in an instant. It is a process. The Apostle James tells us very clearly that this is the way it is. Look in the book of James, the third chapter. He says in verse 2, we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. James says, if the time comes that you do not stumble in word, then you have reached character perfection. You have reached character perfection. That's verse 2. He goes on to say that no one is able to control the tongue. That's in verse 8. It says, no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. No man can tame it. No man can control it. What are you going to do then? The only way that a human being can control their tongue is if they have been born again of the Holy Spirit. Unless the Holy Spirit is controlling my mind, I will not be able to control my tongue. That's the way it works. Things that will happen that are provoking, that are irritating, that are outrageous. And all those kind of things happen in this world. And unless the Holy Spirit is in control of my mind, I will not be able to control what I am speaking. And so James goes on to talk about this. James, the third chapter. And he says, starting verse 13, who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing will be there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Let me tell you something. We spend lots of time and tens of thousands of dollars in evangelistic work to spread the gospel. But you know, all the evangelistic work that any of us can try to do will not build up the church or build up God's cause unless we have control of the tongue. Because anybody from the world that walks into your home or that walks into this church, actually, a person doesn't even need to say much. If a person has a spirit of suspicion or distrust or fault-finding, the other person will pick that up right away. And when they pick that up, they know immediately. If they've studied the Bible at all, the Spirit of God is not in this place, so they won't want to come to this church. So every human being meets with situations in this world which are trying, meets up with other people whose speech is not right. And so, I want to study with you for just a few minutes. What do you do in these certain situations? What do you do when you hear somebody says something that is detrimental to somebody else's character? This is Review and Herald, February 25, 1904. If a word is dropped that is detrimental to the character of a friend or brother, never encourage this evil speaking. for it is the work of the enemy. Remind the speaker that God's word forbids this kind of conversation. God's word forbids me to speak in a way that would degrade your character or destroy your reputation. Now, this can be a very touchy situation. Have you ever been in a situation where somebody was actually doing something that was wrong and you could not go along with it? They're actually doing something wrong so that you can't go along with it. So, you know what happens? Very often what happens, the person that is in that situation, they're actually doing something that's wrong, you won't go along with it. They have a guilty conscience, and so they expect that you are going to destroy or try to destroy their reputation. I've had people say, oh, Pastor John's going to destroy my reputation. I hadn't said anything about him. They had just had a guilty conscience. They thought that I was going to destroy their reputation. I hadn't said anything. But if a word is dropped that is detrimental to the character of someone else, never encourage this evil speaking. You can read in your Bible what the Pharisees did when Jesus was here. It said that they found fault. They found fault. Fault finding is very, very common in our world today. It's very common among politicians, and it's very common in many areas of life. Fault finding. And Jesus was not a person that went around fault finding, even though he was righteous and the rest of the world was that he was living in was wicked. We need to understand what we're talking about when we say fault finding. We have ways to dress it up so that other person doesn't realize what we're doing. One of the ways we dress it up is to make it appear that we're just trying to save the cause of God. We're just trying to do what's something to bring glory to the cause of God, when that's not what we're really doing at all. Let me give you some examples. Now, this is when people get angry, when you give examples. One of the commonest ways to find fault in Adventism today, all over the world, and in our church probably, is to find fault with somebody else's theology. Oh, we're just doing that so that because we need to all think the right thing, and everybody needs to think what I think. You know how that works? That's the way the human mind works. Other people need to think what I think, because I'm right. And so we see infighting among Christians, among Adventists, all over the world, over differences of understanding on points of theology. Now, there are some things in theology that are so dangerous that if a person is mixed up on that point, you need to point out to them what you're saying is contrary to the Bible and show them what the Bible says. That's one thing. But sometimes we find that people get to pointing out problems in somebody else's theology, and the question becomes, who is it that really has the problem? So people come, I have thousands, I think thousands of sheets of paper on this in my office here at the ministry and also at my home. People send me information. And people say, I can prove this. So they give me a whole documentation. Let me give you an example, then you can really get angry with me. I can prove this. I can prove to you from the spirit of prophecy that Satan is going to impersonate Christ before the close of probation. Another person comes and says, I can prove to you from the spirit of prophecy that Satan is going to impersonate Christ after the close of probation, just before the second coming. And so there's a difference of opinion. So people say, that person's wrong. Somebody else says, this person's wrong. This person's wrong. The problem is, on these kind of things, is that there is no explicit statement that says either way, but you're putting statements together, and different people put different statements together. Have you ever noticed that? People do that with the Bible. They put different texts together. People do it with the spirit of prophecy. They put different statements together, and different people do it different, understand different. There's many, many examples of this. Are you aware of the fact that there are Adventist ministers right now on television that are promoting their views about the King of the North? And there is a tremendous difference of opinion on this all over the world. And so, shall we find fault with the person that doesn't believe like I am? Am I absolutely sure that they're wrong and I'm right? Well, people seem to feel that way. So we get involved. I mentioned one example. I'm going to get to another area now. Another way that's common to find fault: we don't find fault with somebody else's theology. We find fault with something about their practice. What is that talking about? Finding fault with their practice. Well, it could be lots of different things. It could be finding fault with the way they are conducting the Lord's work in their area, or what they're doing. It could be finding fault with the way that they eat or the way that they dress. And different people are on different levels. One time several years ago, we had several young ladies come into our church and sit right down here in the middle toward the front that were wearing tight pants. Now, other people said, you know, that's really not appropriate to wear to church. I'm not even sure that those women were Christians, that they came to service that day. And so how do you relate to that? One time, there was a friend of ours. This lady was going through a hard time. My wife thought it would be a good idea to take her to an Adventist camp meeting. And so my wife took this lady to an Adventist camp meeting, hoping that she would get blessed. In worldly standards, she was dressed very conservatively and modestly. But when my wife and this woman walked into the camp meeting, almost immediately a gentleman came up, and about the first thing that he said to her was a rebuke about the way she was dressed. And I thought, oh dear, is this woman going to get destroyed because we have no tact, no feeling, no conscience, no understanding of the other person? He didn't even know who she was. How did he know that she was even a Christian? What if she had come there directly from the dance hall? And so, very often, whether it's theology or whether it's practice, when we get involved in finding fault with somebody, as we engage in that, both the speaker and the listener lose the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will not live in your heart and your mind while you're talking like that, while you're living like that. That won't happen. And so then people wonder, they come to the pastor, why don't we have the Holy Spirit in our church? Have you ever heard an evil report? You ever heard an evil report? Some people seem to have a natural talent for making evil reports. I want to read to you something that Ellen White wrote about that. She said that the Lord had instructed her on this point many times. This is what she says. I have been especially instructed in regard to the danger of drawing apart and of evil speaking and contention. We need to bow before God in repentance because of our lack of love for one another and for Him who died for us. The gold of love and faith is not abundant among us. Many are holding on to the truth with but the tips of their fingers. The precious time that should be spent in speaking of the Savior's power to save is being spent by many in carrying evil reports. so-and-so, somebody in this church, doesn't understand the plan of salvation. When a person says that, what do they mean? They mean they don't understand it the way I understand it. How do I know that they're all wrong and I'm all right? How do I know that? Well, the fact is, I don't. The precious time that should be spent in speaking of the Savior's power to save is being spent by many in carrying evil reports. Unless they make a decided change, they will be found wanting. Unless they have an entire transformation of character, they will never enter heaven. Oh, you ought to be saved. Remember what Jesus said to Nicodemus? There is no chance for you to be in the kingdom of heaven unless you're born of water and of the Spirit. And if I'm born of the Spirit, one of the first things that will happen, it'll start to change the way I talk. And so, when I open my mouth, are people being blessed or are people being cursed? Let me read this to you. Those who spend their time in thinking and speaking evil are bringing to the foundation material represented by hay, wood, and stubble, which will be consumed by the fires of the last days. They will one day see that their time has been spent in weakening churches, institutions, and conferences. God hates all such work. He will call to account all who engage in it. So, have you read in Proverbs 31 the definition of a virtuous woman? It's a very interesting description in Proverbs 31, verse 26. It says, "She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness." The law of kindness. We need to overcome all harshness. Eternity alone will reveal the harm that harsh words do to those who utter them and to those that hear. I want to read to you the answer that a schoolgirl gave to when she was asked how she would define meekness. This is the way she answered. This is a schoolgirl. When asked a definition of meekness, she said, "Meek people are those who give soft answers to rough questions." Soft answers to rough questions. The only people that will enter heaven. Let me read this to you. The only people who will enter heaven will be those who have overcome the temptation to think and speak evil. We haven't even covered some other areas of speech that we need to thoroughly understand, such as words of passion. Have you ever heard two people get into an argument and it develops into a shouting match? Have you heard that? You seen that? It says, when in speech and action you give way to passion, you are acting as a sinner, and as a sinner you are under condemnation, needing to repent and be converted. My dear friend, the Holy Spirit has power to enable you and me to change the way that we speak. The Holy Spirit has the power to give you the ability to have the law of kindness on your lips when you speak. It will change everything in your home. Let me tell you something else. If things are changed in our homes, things will change in our church. When things are not going good in a church, the reason that things aren't going good in a church is because there's trouble in the families in that church. That's the reason, always. I could read you from Upward Look, page 163, about that. We're out of time. The devil's work is to try to stir up strife and contention in every family and to destroy the happiness in the family, because he knows that if he is able to destroy the happiness of the family, it will eventually destroy the church, because the church is the sum of all the families that are in the church. The Lord wants to give to you and to me a new heart. A new heart. A new spirit. We have to have this new heart and this new spirit if we're going to go to the kingdom of heaven. And so many times, and I'm a preacher too, so I take the blame as well as all the other preachers. We describe it and we just say, well, you just have to be born again. But we don't understand what we're talking about in practical terms. If I'm really born again, it will change the way I'm speaking. And if the way I'm speaking has not been changed, I haven't been born again. I'm just pretending to be religious. Our time's more than gone. Before we sing our closing song, let's pray that the Lord will help us, that we'll be born again. Do you want to be born again? So that it'll change the way you live, the way you speak? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that when we were lost, when we were ruined, that you devised a way so that we could be forgiven of our guilt by the blood of Jesus Christ poured out for us on the cross of Calvary. We thank you that you provided a way that through the power of the third person of the Godhead, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we might each one receive power to control the tongue, which none of us can control of our own. And Lord, we pray, as we choose to surrender our hearts, our minds to the sovereignty of Jesus Christ, to follow Him, to not be doing just what we want to do, but to surrender to a higher power, to live in harmony with His law, we pray that your Holy Spirit will come into our hearts and minds to change us, to change the way we speak, to change the way we think about others, so that we will become eligible to be citizens of that kingdom where no transgressor can enter. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.